All you got to do is just walk away and pass me by. Don't acknowledge my smile when I try and say hello to you. And all you've got to do is not answer my calls when...
Kind of About Music podcast.
Hello and welcome to episode 6 of the Kind of About Music podcast. Today's episode is with the incredibly talented Miss Shantéh Fuller. She's a singer and songwriter from right here in London, and she's got an EP coming out on the 22nd of June. So I suggest you go and download that from iTunes. You can follow her on Twitter at Shantéh Fuller, which is S-H-A-N-T-E-H-F-U-L-L-E-R. So that's at Shantéh Fuller, that's her Twitter handle, and on Facebook she's got an artist page for Shantéh Fuller. If you follow her on there, she'll no doubt post links to how to get the EP on iTunes, and I'll be doing the same, I'll be retweeting that, so keep an eye out for that. Yeah, Shantéh's incredible. She's one of the first people I met on the London jam scene, and she's very kind and very warm, and then eventually was daft enough to ask me to play some guitar for her, which I did on the EP. And she's brilliant, and the podcast was so much fun. It was just we also had our friend Tim sat in with us as well. He was just helping us do the put stuff together and build, put all the equipment up and everything. But it was nice to have him in the room as well. So look out for Tim chiming in every so often. I don't think we abuse him very much in the podcast, which I think we meant to send him some abuse more often, but we didn't quite get around to it, actually. Next time he's on, we'll do that. So anyway, enjoy the podcast. Make sure you subscribe so you can stay up to date with future podcasts. Leave me some comments. I haven't had many comments on YouTube, or even on the Facebook, when I post it on Facebook or Twitter. If you've got some ideas about how I can make it better, what I can do more of, what I can do less of, leave me a comment, because I'm always interested in finding out ways to improve it. If you want to follow me on social media, all the links are in the description, but it's basically Jim GuitarMan, so at Jim GuitarMan for Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. You can find me on all of that. Anyway, that's enough of me talking. Enjoy the podcast. Shantéh's amazing. Pay special attention to when she sings. She sings a Michael Jackson song called Butterflies. And I was listening back to that afterwards, and I realised that she actually makes her voice sound like a butterfly while she's doing it, while she's doing the improv at the end, which I asked her about and she wasn't even aware of. So, pretty incredible stuff. She's amazing. It was a lot of fun. Enjoy.
Maybe I'm just too damn selfish. I got a holy bullet in my eye. Mom said it's too much too early, and I don't know if I'm wasting my time. And I don't wanna leave you with the responsibility to handle my insecurities. No, 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 that's not fair. Yeah, cause I don't wanna flee, it's not a crime scene. But the longer that I stay, it might kill me. Cause hurt people hurt people, and I'm feeling kinda hurt, so I don't wanna hurt you. Want to be happy, but it feels so far away right now. I really want to be happy, but it feels so far away right now. I tried so hard to fight it, I didn't want to be persuaded. I tried so hard to fight it, yeah, but then it got complicated. Maybe I don't understand long suffering, but I'm turning into someone else. Carrying around your emotions ain't for me, so I think I need to leave, get some time by myself. 'Cause I don't wanna leave you with the responsibility to handle my insecurities. No, 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 that's not fair. No, no, 'cause I don't wanna flee, it's not a crime scene, but the longer that I stay, it might kill me. 'Cause hurt people, and I'm feeling kinda hurt, so I don't wanna hurt you.
I really want to be happy, but feel so far away right now.
I really want to be happy.
I really want to be happy, but feel so far away right now.
That was all right.
I didn't mess up the harmony on it. I don't think I did. Did I mess up the harmony?
No, you did it right. Okay. It was good. I'm proud of you.
Shantéh, thank you for being on my podcast.
Thanks for
everybody at home, this is Shantéh Fuller, Miss Shantéh Fuller.
Yay.
That's one of your own songs, isn't it?
It is.
Tell us about your songs and what's happening in them.
Okay. That song was called, it is called Hurt People, Hurt People.
Yeah. Sounds, I love the name of that song.
Thanks. It's got some interesting comments about it because it sounds a bit crazy, but there's a meaning for it, as you heard in the song.
Right, so the name of it is Hurt People, Hurt People.
There's a comma.
Yeah.
So people know it's not like you're continually hurting people.
Yeah, so at first it can sound like somebody's, in a voice talking to themselves, maybe a psycho is in a voice talking to themselves, like, hurt people.
Okay. Yeah,
it's, but it's not like, it's a lot pretty, it's a lot nicer than that, yeah, isn't it? Tell us a little bit about it.
So it was literally, if you really slowed the sentence down.
Sorry, I've just ruined this sentiment of a really nice song.
It's all right. It's okay. So I'll briefly explain it and say what it's about. I was seeing someone and they were really great. They were cool. And they just got really annoying. Yeah, and yeah. And it's not like they were a bad person. I feel like they were just in their own problems a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
So I couldn't be there, not just to help them, but just be there for them, because being around them meant that I was then upset all the time.
Okay.
And I'm genuinely quite a happy person, and generally quite a happy person, so...
You are quite a happy person.
Yeah.
Sometimes insufferably happy.
Oh.
No, I'm joking. No, it's very nice.
No. But yeah, no, he was... I don't know, I think he was going through stuff, and I feel bad because if he watches it, then it's life in it. But
well, I've not said any names, and it's my podcast, there's probably nobody watching it. It's probably Tim, we've got Tim in the room helping us, our friend Tim.
Hi, Tim.
He's maybe he'll watch it, and us maybe.
Yeah. Can I call him Tim for now then?
Yeah.
Because it's just, I need a name. So Tim, yeah? Tim was...
Oh, right. Really, so you and Tim were dating?
Yeah, okay. Me and Tim were dating. No, but yeah, no, this, he was a good guy, but I just feel like he was in a lot of his own problems and he didn't really express them. And in turn, it made the very short, I don't even call it a relationship, really, because it was very short, but it made it really difficult. So I couldn't just be his friend and I couldn't support him. I couldn't do a lot. And then when I would say, oh, stuff is going wrong with me, he was just so in his own head that he couldn't help me either. So it literally was like, hurt people, like I'm hurting, hurt people, hurt people. I don't want to hurt his feelings if I'm hurting too. So I'd rather like just disappear.
Yeah.
That's what it's about, really.
I think it's great. I was saying this to somebody in one of to my friend Chris Aspin in the first podcast that I did.
That was good, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
You met Shantéh is a, I met Shantéh at a jam night at the Bay, where was it? It's Smith's of
Spitalfields.
Yeah, they had a jam. Natalie Palmer was running the jam in the basement. And I turned up worrying everybody was going to be a bit of a douchebag and a bit cliquey in London.
Yeah.
And you just went, hey, who are you?
I did.
I think I was there with Sam Weston as well.
Yes.
And he kind of knew you. And then you saw me. I saw you at Sam Weston and Chelsea's Jam Marmalade.
Yeah.
And you were like, Jim, come sit with us. And you had the crutches, didn't you?
I did, because I was with my leg.
And it's so nice. It's so nice that someone's so warm and stuff. But I was talking about your lyrics with a friend of mine in the first podcast, Chris Aspin, and was saying like I've worked with a lot of female vocalists, and you get people who write in lyrics from the lyric playbook.
Yeah.
One of my favorite, like, overused lyrics and stuff like that, and yours aren't like that. And that's why when you sent me the stuff when you asked me to play some guitar for you, I was very honoured.
I was very happy.
Because I just heard you sing a lot at jam nights. I was listening to the lyrics, and they're great. They're like, you can tell that they actually mean something, rather than just writing them kind of lyrics by numbers or something like that, and rhyming classic things and baby and love and all that. And one of my favourite overused lyrics is "To Make a Brighter Day." Who started that off?
I don't know. I'm trying to think. There must be a gospel song with that in
it. There's a million songs with that in it.
Yeah. But no, I think most of the songs that I write, sounds weird. Some of them I have dreams about, and I hear stuff and I'm like, ooh, voices. Not crazy like that, but I'll have dreams sometimes with songs in them and I'm like, okay, that's pretty cool. Or they're diary pages, or they're poems that I wrote ages ago.
Yeah.
Or they just appear when I say, I could say to my friend, let's record today. He's like, yeah, you've got songs ready? I'm like, yeah, I've got loads of songs. Yeah. Don't have any songs.
Yeah.
And I get there, and literally like 5 minutes before I walk through the door, I just get loads of ideas in my head and I just start writing them down. And then when I sing them and I listen to them back, I'm like, oh, that happened in my life 5 years ago. I didn't know I was writing it like that. So most of the stuff doesn't rhyme.
I love that, because you're kind of, you're like, it's obvious that you're very creative and you're like a naturally creative person. And so the lyrics aren't forced, and that's why the lyrics sound natural and they sound, I mean, this we're putting aside the voice that you've got, which is incredible as well, if you don't mind me saying.
Thank you. I'm not you, though. I'm not Jim.
No, you're not me.
No, sorry.
But apart from that aside, like, the lyrics really are great in it, and you can just tell, like, it's natural. It's not coming from a kind of, oh, I'm going to write a hit song or I'm going to get famous or anything. Like, that might, I'm surprised that does happen, but it's actually kind of coming from a place of natural creativity, and I think that's great.
Really appreciate that.
And that's why you probably find it so easy when you walk in. Talking about producer, that's Dre, isn't it?
Yes.
He's brilliant. And his brother Dana.
Yes.
Yeah.
They are sick. The best ever.
Dana's the bass player.
Yep.
He scared the hell out of me when he started running some bass licks in the warm-up where I came and did some recording with you. And he's incredible, isn't he?
Dana is a beast. Like, he's just turned 19 and he's killing, like, everyone. Like, Dana will walk to a gig and you've got people that are playing bass for like 20, 30 years and they're like, wait, Dana's coming. I've got to make sure I'm in tune. Let me change my strings. Let me warm up like for 2 months in advance before I see Dana again. Like, he's so good. And him and his brother, Andre, they gig a lot together, and we grew up together in church. And I'm a part of the choir that his dad runs called RDMC. And you and Tim came to a concert recently, which was really good. It was a celebration of his birthday and also 22 years of the choir going. Yeah. So I think because they've grown up just having music in their house all the time, and their mum's part of the choir too.
Yeah.
So they've grown up with music in their house all the time, and they have this great bond. So when they work together, sounds really great. And I'm really privileged because I get to work together with them. And it's nice. To me, they're my family. So if I do anything or go anywhere, I want them to come with me.
Oh, that's
so
brilliant. Andre's what's his production thing called? Is he called Dre Fish
on a beat?
Sorry, say that again.
No. His name's Andre Fisher. We just call him Dre Fish.
All right, but doesn't he put that on his?
He doesn't just like put it on the beat. Like, it's not like the beginning of the song.
No, I'm
like,
sure when I got it in iTunes,
it's not like
a watermark. No, I'm sure that. But I'm sure that's what it said next on the file, and I was looking at it. But no, he's a drummer, isn't he?
Yes.
But then when I was there again in his studio, he was laying down
some keys,
but with chords that just like, there's too many notes there, dude. What's going on there?
Yeah.
Like, but not in a bad way, in a great way. And he's like, oh, it's a,
it's, I can't, like, even B-flat remember what. B flat minor, 7, 9, flat in the diminished section of life.
Yeah,
like,
B flat minor, cool. Yeah. But then there's all the extra extensions on top of it, and he just hears it, and it's great. And he's a drummer.
Yeah, that drums is his first instrument, and then like I guess when you play and you gig and you kind of have to pick up other stuff, and he jumps on keys because he produces too, so he kind of just uses it all.
Very nice production as well. I said that to you when I got it as well. It's really kind of it's really clean, and it's really kind of it's got a great kind of atmosphere to it, like vibe to it.
You know sometimes you listen to music and there's so much going on but there's just not enough space, so you can't appreciate what's actually going on like throughout the track, but with that particular song, really like it. Like there's some other songs that we've got together that are really like quite in your face, but he's done it in a way that it doesn't overpower the vocals, or the vocals don't overpower the drum in the mix, or this doesn't overpower that. And it's really nice because there's like obviously there's live instruments on it, but then there's loads of production stuff that was just like put in by Logic, but it all sounds quite fluid.
Well, he definitely got a good vision for how you and him together of how it all fits together and stuff, and it seemed, as I say, natural is a word that just seems organic. Like I was going to say about Dana, like turned up in his flip flops, walked in, and he's like messing around, and he just sits down and goes, "Ready?"
Yeah,
it's like, okay, well, all right. And it was all a big joke to him, like, and that's the best play as it is. Like if you watch some of the guys that we see at jam nights and stuff like that in London, the best ones they're laughing and having a conversation all the way through. Rather than being like, oh God.
Yeah, because it's not that serious. Like,
exactly, yeah.
I feel like...
But it takes a very high level of skill to get to that point.
Like when I say it's not that serious, it's not, but he's dedicated. Yeah. So he's allowed to do that.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's not like, it's a joke to me, so I think everyone else sucks. Like, he's genuinely good.
Yeah.
And he's just a lovely person, so he laughs at everything. So to him, he'll rock up in flip-flops. Yeah. And there was a point, like, him and Andre were just, like, cussing each other the whole way through, like, before we'd even started. Before we'd even recorded, he was just like, what are you doing? He's like, obviously, I'm producing. He's just like, yeah, but can you do this? It's just so random, but I guess it's that brotherly dynamic.
Definitely.
Which is cool.
He's... And they just made it so easy to do it as well. And it was like, it was just like hanging out. It was great. We did some of your songs at the Vocal and Verses thing, which I put a clip of in the first podcast that I did.
Yeah.
I hope they are all right with that.
No, it's fine.
But I linked to the video as well in it as well. And I'll link to it on it. If you want to check out Shantéh singing live, what you search, Vocal and Verses, Shantéh Fuller.
Yeah.
How do you spell your name? It's S-H... It's going you to spell it.
You can try it if you want.
S-H-A-N-T... E with an apostrophe over it, like
an accent.
Yeah, and then a H. Shantéh.
I'm so proud of you.
And then Fuller, F-U-L-L-E-R. Well, it's none of us can spell too. You know?
I'm so proud.
When we want to.
Yeah, no, that's how you spell my name. It's good. Yeah.
Well, how I want to spell your name as Northerner is like with all the vowels dropped out.
Oh, can you say it?
S H N T H.
So just say it.
F-L-L.
Oh. Say it without...
No, I'm not doing that.
Is it like Shantéh Fuller?
Yeah. Shantéh spends a lot of time on the phone doing impressions of me to me. Does she do this to you?
Never had a phone call, Shantéh.
Right, yeah. Well, she leaves voicemail messages. No, she phones me up and it's, all right, Jim, how are you doing? Do you know what I'm having for dinner? Some gravy. And then she sends me clips of her sister doing the same thing. It's like... Now, oh great, now your family's mocking me. Awesome.
I said to him, like, no one, before I met you, no one knew who you were. And we were doing this in the house before. And I don't know why, but I feel like because everyone's so musical, we just pick up on stuff really quickly. So we've got family that live in Peterborough, Birmingham, and we used to go up to the Midlands a lot for like conventions growing up. So we were just always surrounded by people talking like this all the time. And then you got my granddad with his thick Jamaican accent, and then you've got like all these random aunties and uncles. So after a while, you just pick stuff up. But the Northern, Andre does it too.
Yeah.
He was like, you're right, Jim. Everyone does it. I don't know why. It's endearing.
That's fine. Yeah. It's nice to get phone calls. I don't mind. Even if they're mocking me, it's fine.
Sorry, I don't get phone calls either. It's fine.
What was I going to say? Yeah, so if you want to check out Shantéh's a video of Shantéh, I thought it was a really good one as well. It's one of your songs called, which one is it? It's because we did three on the, no, we did four
that
on
was,
the gig.
That video was Hurt People, Hurt People.
No, the video isn't. Oh. No, it's not the one released. Yeah. No, it's not.
What are you talking
about?
It's
Lost and Found, the vocals and verses one.
Lost and Found. Yeah.
Which I can't actually remember at the moment, the guitar part for it, so we can't do it now. But check it out on YouTube. Vocals and verses, Shantéh Fuller, Lost and Found.
Yeah.
You might see a weird guy sat at the back.
Yeah,
going
it's
in
Jim.
And, going in and playing guitar.
That's Jim.
The guys who were on after us, that was a great gig. I really enjoyed that because it was a totally different vibe from it was like a Sunday afternoon. And everyone was just super like into it straight away and just enjoyed it, really supportive. I liked the wrap off that they have in the middle of
that. That was so much fun. That's so good. The verse off, so they throw out a word from the audience. So the audience are just shouting out things like sunshine, bacon, Caesar salad. And they've got to like rap. So. Oh, you should definitely do this next time.
Yeah, Tim, you'd be definitely
good. But they literally throw out words and they don't tell the audience that they're about to have a rap off until they're like, okay, cool, you're against her, go. And they're like, oh my
god. Yeah, yeah. One of the girl basically just cried off, didn't she? She didn't
pretty much.
Anything.
She was kind of like, chicken. And then she ran off. Like, cause it was, she didn't want to do it. And then there was, I can't remember what the guy was rapping about, but. He did really well. I think he did like a spoken word poetry thing and he won. He won tickets to the next show, which I actually went to the other day, which was really good.
Oh, did you?
One happened on Sunday at the Hospital Club again.
Yeah, that's a cool place as well. It was a private members club in
Covent Garden,
yeah.
Yeah, really great.
I liked on the gig we did, the guy was on after us. What was his name? Something D'Angelo or?
Angelo Dissens, I think.
Yeah.
Angelo Dissens, really
he good. He was great. And he was blown away when you did the sound check by your voice. He was like, whoa.
He's so sweet.
But his band was like, they were all like 17, weren't they? These little kids with these massive bass guitar. And
one of them, the bassist is called Courtney Rowe. And I've known him since he was like tiny.
Yeah.
And he used to go to Brit School.
And
he's so lovely. So it's nice to see him playing. But then, I don't know, I saw him playing and I saw Angelo singing. And I didn't put two and two together until after the sound check that they're all like 12 years old. And I was like, oh my God, they're not 12. I need to stop saying
don't
that.
Don't make me feel worse than what I already feel.
Okay, they were 16 to 19.
Yeah.
But when they introduced them at the end, they were like, okay, you've got to introduce your friends. And they were like, yeah, we go way back, you know. And we were like, how old are you? Like, oh, he's 16. It's like, what?
Yeah.
Way back to what?
Like, it was so good. It was so tight, such good players. And this is one of the things about like people who play in church and gospel people, what you call gospel musicians, I suppose. Like, what I've seemed to figured out or think is that, like, when I started playing guitar, my dad was a professional guitar player, so I kind of always had half an eye on it. But I didn't start playing until I was about 15.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was 15, it was because I'd seen a video of Slash. And I wanted to be Slash and get famous in a band and tour the world and whatever. But what I found is that I didn't actually do a lot of playing. I was concentrating on trying to be rock and roll for the first 5 years of my musical career. I mean, I did do a lot of playing, but with gospel musicians, it seems like from the age of like 5 or 6, they're in a church with an instrument, playing 3 hours at a time.
Even younger.
Without worrying about getting famous or being this or being that, just playing the songs that set there, learn them and then be creative.
Mm.
And that just seems to be a lot more wholesome and interesting.
Yeah.
And there's a reason why a lot of the top musicians in London are gospel musicians as well.
Yeah.
Or musicians with a gospel background.
Yeah. It's an interesting one because I think as you get older, I guess I can talk from a gospel perspective. When you get older, you realise, okay, yeah, if you want to pursue music, you can.
Exactly.
And sometimes you do get a bit of stick from, like, you know, back home. It's like, oh, but you're not playing in the church or anything anymore. And it's not like we're not playing in the church anymore. It's just that we have a skill that can be taken outside of these four walls.
Mm.
And I think it's just a conflict between, like, the seniors maybe and just the younger people. That's the only downfall.
Well,
I think,
the younger
sometimes.
People are always going to get to a point where they want to make a bigger name for themselves.
Yeah,
or actually,
of course.
But I love the idea that it starts off from a really kind of place of it's just about the music.
Yeah.
Which I can't say that I wholly had my eye on just the music. I mean, it was like a way to get girls or whatever, or as part of the idea of the lifestyle as well. But someone like Dana, who's 19 and that good.
Yeah.
The only way you can do that is if you spend hours playing live and hours playing in your room, and it's like you're trying to figure out all this stuff, and you've got all this. Also, the people around you are so good because the people in church who are older than you will be playing, and you'll go, "Oh, what was that?" And I think that's what a lot of young musicians who aren't gospel or church players miss. definitely miss out on.
I agree with you. I was trying not to agree with you because I just don't want to sound biased or anything. But
no, but it's true because the level's just so much higher at such a younger age. I always say, make the analogy with football. Like Spanish footballers are better than English footballers because at 5 or 6 they're just trying to be skillful, not trying to.
They're not trying to do anything in particular. They're just just trying to have a good time.
Yeah,
that's literally it.
Whereas if you go into English football leagues, their dads are shouting them at. I remember playing matches where 7 years old and the dads are fighting on the like what is this? Like, is the FA Cup final? But musically, that's the same as well. Like, you know, it's all about battle of the bands and trying to get fit. It doesn't make any sense when I think about it.
Because if you're battling and you're crap, what's the point? Like,
yeah, it's not about that.
No, because the thing is, if you take away the battle, can you actually play? Like, can you actually sing? Can you perform?
Yeah.
And if not, then go back to the drawing board and just enjoy yourself because you miss so much of the process, and the process is the best bit. Like, when you have your name in lights and you've got these plaques and these CDs and... That's great, but if you didn't enjoy any of it, like getting to it, then you might as well just be like an accountant. Like, no offense to accountants, but like you might as well.
No, offend accountants, they deserve it.
I don't think they do, because at some point I'm going to need them. I'm going to need one day. but yeah, you miss out on the journey. And I think growing up in church, I guess culturally as well, just music around, like music has such a big influence. In my family, I'll talk for my family alone, but it has such a massive influence just with the different types of music we grew up listening to. My mum used to write poetry. She used to play drums too.
Yeah,
And my sisters sing, and one plays keys, one plays drums. I sing, I dabble on some bass every so often when I like decide to leave my room and tell people, and then I just kind of hibernate again, which I shouldn't do. I should actually just start playing it more often. And yeah, like they taught themselves because they just like, oh, this is fun. Like, I like this instrument. So everyone just taught themselves stuff. And
it seems to come from a place of like enjoyment and creative and trying to help other people enjoy. And in the age of like X Factor and The Voice and all that sort of thing, people forget that like people used to use a piano in a house as entertainment, used to get around as a family and sing. Like, that's missing from most families in Britain's lives, and that's so sad. I remember my grandma playing and us singing with my grandma. I remember when we moved house and my dad and my uncle got on the piano and we had it in the garden because they hadn't quite moved it into the house, and it was the summer and they were playing and people were coming around and then all of a sudden that just stops.
That sounds amazing though.
it's most fun memory that I've had, and most of them are to do with groups of people playing music in family situation, but it doesn't happen very much now. It's all about, have you got the look and this weird X Factor voice that I just don't... I know some people who've been on X Factor who are really talented or The Voice have been really talented, but in general, that kind of...
That thing.
Singing loud and frilly, if you like.
Yeah.
What... change subject, because we've not got much time today, and I want to get some more songs in. I was going to say, one of the things that was an education to me when I came to London is... going to the Jam Notes, which is where I met you. And I remember one night at the basement, got up and played a Flowetry song.
Mm-hmm.
You do a Flowetry song now that we might do in a bit, but that was another one that we were going to do, Butterflies.
Let's do that.
Yeah, we're going to do Butterflies. Yeah. Okay. So I really hadn't known much about Neo Soul. I'd heard but I didn't know any artists or any tunes. And I got up at the Jam Night and someone said, what they were going to sing, because you don't know till you get up what the singer's going to sing. And she said it was Say Yes by Flowetry.
Who sang that? Says,
I've forgotten who
was
it was.
Was that at Natalie's night?
Yeah, Natalie Palmer's night, yeah, the basement. And the bass player looks cross and he said, oh, it's fine, don't worry about it. It's G minor ninth, F minor ninth, E flat minor ninth, D flat major seventh. And I went, whoa. what key is that in? Because that doesn't make much sense. Now, that's just because I hadn't known much about it. And Golden's another one. It's like there's four major seventh chords. And you're like, what key does it? Yeah. That was an education to me to get into the... And it's still not my strongest suit, but I like, neo-soul is a totally different animal. Like, because he explained, oh, it's just a hip-hop groove. And I was like, all right, okay. Mm-hmm. And then we played it, I was like...
This is not what you said.
Yeah, so I had to go and do some learning and figuring out about that. But yeah, you do Butterflies, which is written by Flowetry.
Yes.
But it was on the Michael Jackson Invincible album, and it was one of the best songs on that.
Indeed.
That strange that they didn't release. They released Rock My World instead, which I'd...
Yeah, I think that was just the one to get the crowd a bit amped up, because you had, what, Chris Tucker was in it?
Yeah.
Chris Tucker was in the video.
Yeah.
Didn't they just do, like, a Rush Hour movie as well?
Maybe, yeah.
And
yeah, yeah.
I think it was just before MJ's last performance, before yeah. the This Is It tour.
Yeah, and the Illuminati got him.
Let's not talk about that today, I'm not doing it, because I love MJ and I think everyone's trying to kill him on purpose, but I love him. It's okay, I'm not doing it today.
Let's do the song.
So upset with you right now. All you got to do is just walk away and pass me by. Don't acknowledge my smile when I try and say hello to you. Yeah. And all you've got to do is not answer my calls when I'm trying to get through. Keep me wondering why, and all I can do is sigh. I just wanna touch and kiss, and I wish that I could be with you tonight, 'cause you give me butterflies inside. Now I just wanna say that I must be dreaming, can't be real, you're not here with me. And now I can feel you near to me. Yeah, I caress you, let you chase love, yes, so listen, I would give anything, baby, just make my dreams come true. Oh, baby, you give me, I just wanna touch and kiss, and I wish that I could be with you tonight. You give me butterflies inside, and I just wanna touch and kiss, and I wish that I could be with you tonight. Oh, you give me butterflies.
That's great, that song. Well done.
Thanks.
Yeah, Neo Soul, I had to do some learning about that. But the chords are so nice. And I see like something like Golden.
It should be interesting, because every time I sing the song, I get the verses in the wrong order. But it's alright, because Jill Scott will have to love me. I really love her.
Taking my freedom, putting it on the shelf, putting it on a chain, wearing it round my neck. I'm taking my freedom, putting it in my stroll. I'll be all stepping y'all, letting my joy unfold. I'm living my life like it's golden, 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 living my life like it's golden. I'm living my life like it's golden, living my life like it's golden, living my life like it's golden, living my life like it's golden. Let's see the living my life like it's golden, 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 golden. I'm living my life like it's golden, 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 golden.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. So that's not a chord progression. It's not a chord progression I would have come across before, having to do some neo soul and someone.
Not when you were listening to Slash.
Yeah, exactly. Well, no, yeah. I started off as a metalhead and yeah, and then got into more like, because funk, hip hop, knew that's not a problem.
Tim, did Jim tell you about the pictures he has with the longest hair in the world, where he thought he was literally like the lead singer in Avenged Sevenfold? Sorry.
Whoa, Avenged Sevenfold is not a metal band.
I'm just saying that you looked like the lead singer. I didn't say you played like the lead singer. No. You obviously played like Slash.
No, the bands that I was into as metalhead were bands that like Down and Crowbar, okay, and Mastodon and yeah, Pantera, like real okay, kind of manly bands. None of this pretty boy metal of Avenged Sevenfold and whiny emo stuff.
Oh,
anyway,
man.
No offense to anyone.
I liked Bullet for My Valentine, but they're not obviously strong, heavy metal man, angry man stuff. That was like college days.
Yeah.
I had an emo phase, kind of.
Well, thank God you forgot about that and got back into.
Yeah.
But one of the things that surprised me is you actually, when we're at jam nights, and if you are a musician in London and you don't go to these jam nights, you should go and check them out, because they're, for a start, they're an education, because of the people that you see playing, they're just so good. Like,
yeah.
What's the bass player that was down at Chiro's, the Italian guy?
Frederico Malaman
came down and did Do I Do at like twice the speed. Yeah, he did it at twice the speed of the original, and just him and his guitar player, and just wrecked it. And we were all Ryan Shore as well. The first time I went down to Chiro's in Knightsbridge, Ryan Shore, he's got Grammy nominations and stuff like that, and he did a 10-minute, 15-minute version of Man in the Mirror, and then Remember the Time after that.
Oh,
and
God,
it was like something from a film. It was insane. Yeah. We were just like, everyone jumping around.
Yeah.
Patrick's waving his towel around.
Ryan Shore is amazing.
He's incredible. I nick stuff off him for guitar solos all the time.
Oh,
like,
yeah,
ideas. Like, he's. And I was just thinking about that, because when you were doing Butterflies, I mean, you're doing the same thing. You don't really sing the tune most of the time. You sing around it and sing like improvisations and stuff off it. And it's really creative. And I'm a very guitar player. Like, you get trapped into shapes on a guitar.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the worst instruments for it.
Yeah.
Because, like, on a sax, you don't have shapes, I don't think. And on the piano.
You kind of do.
Yeah. And on piano. Okay, but most sax players don't play like they've got shapes.
Oh, sorry.
Guitar players, though, because you've got. And how a lot of guitar players learn, you get stuck into doing these generic licks. So to have someone like yourself, or Ryan Shaw, or Jennifer down at Chiro's, or any of these top singers, or whatever instrument it is, doing these. This really creative improvisation. It's like, right, I can take something of that. And it becomes, straight away, your playing becomes less generic and less straightforward and less guitar-y.
Yeah.
Because you're actually thinking about melody and rhythm. Like, if you tried to transcribe what you were just singing on some of that, it'd be like the timing would be really tricky to write.
Yeah.
And some of the notes are kind of sliding around and bent notes and stuff. It's brilliant. But yeah, if you're a musician in London, you don't go to the jam nights, go and check out Ronnie Scott's on every other Tuesday.
Ronnie Scott's every other Tuesday,
Ruby Sings. We get
Sam
a lot,
Smith,
though.
Not Sam Smith, imagine. Sam Naffy.
Sam Naffy, yeah.
He hosts one of the nights.
Yeah, we went to it on
the
Tuesday.
The Zealots nights, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And that's really good. Sam has a crazy
If you like neo-soul, go down to Hoxton Jam on a... Troy Bar on a Tuesday night.
Troy Bar on a Tuesday.
Yeah.
That will knock your socks off.
You can't get in the place. You've got to get in there 2 hours before it starts to get sacked down.
Otherwise, you're going to sit outside and cry on the little bit light bit on the inside, so it's quite sad.
You might sit and cry on the inside when you're watching them as well, because
incredible. Jesse J was down there the other night, apparently. No, he just rocked up. It's really good. Erica Badu's been down there a couple of times as well, like a few years ago. Like, people just show up and it's amazing.
That's what I love about London. Like, you don't know. I'd say Daniel Bedingfield came into Chiro's the other day as well.
Like,
and he was insane.
Great.
He was great. He sang the longest, straightest, most in-tune note I've ever heard anybody sing. There's no vibrato on it, and it was perfectly in tune.
On a reggae song.
Yeah, on a reggae song. Yeah. It was amazing.
Crazy.
It was
so
amazing.
Good.
It was just there. It was like a structure in the air, the note that he was singing. I was just like, no vibrato whatsoever. Like, because vibrato, it helps you keep the note around in tune, doesn't it?
Sometimes.
That's not necessarily, but you very rarely is anyone sing such a long, straight, powerful note with no vibrato, almost as a pointer to say, watch this.
Yeah, no, it's true.
It was incredible. But a lot of times at jam nights, we'll get up together because you've got Jim. And you play, which surprised me a lot as well. Like, you sing a lot of rock.
Yeah.
And rock stuff. Like, you were saying that there's only me and our friend Joe Chiari who played with that can remember how to play Little Wing.
Yeah.
And that's one of your favourite songs, isn't
it? That is like top five.
Did I tell you that my friend Tom Atta, he did the music for the Handel and Hendrix house. So he
with it's gonna get on my nerves. Finish off my sentence.
Well, they've got this flat where they lived in the same apartment,
mm-hmm.
and but 200 years apart. And then when you walk around, there's like music of Hendrix playing on a guitar or something, like an acoustic at home. And it's Tom.
That's
my
amazing.
Friend Tom, yeah. And my other friend Ari, and they were saying, like, they were stood there and they were hearing the music playing. They were like, I'm listening to myself play guitar in Jimi Hendrix's house.
That's so cool.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. Little Wing, we do that, and you sing it, and you sing a great version of it. So let's do it.
Let's try.
If I can remember it now I've said that I can remember it. Otherwise, I might have to do some editing.
Don't get it wrong. She's walking through the clouds with a circus mind that's running wild. Butterflies and zebras and moonbeams and fairy tales. Is all she ever thinks about, riding with the wind. When I'm sailing, he comes to me with a thousand smiles he gives to me free. It's alright, he said, it's alright. Take anything you want from me, anything, anything. Fly on, little wind. We shall end it there. Did you see my spirit fingers?
Oh yeah, jazz fingers. Yeah. Oh no,
jazz hands.
Okay, so yeah, this is before we do end it. Like, Shantéh has this thing where she sings, where she dances, she acts out the. She's always dancing and always singing, which is another sign that somebody's super, super creative, and that's great. But when you sang vocals for Ginger Baker, didn't you?
I did.
And I met Ginger Baker afterwards because
you did.
Of you. Although I didn't talk to him because he looked pretty ill, didn't he?
He did.
Yeah. But when Shantae's singing, she's dancing out, and whatever the instrument was playing, while she wasn't singing or while she was singing, you were acting out like.
Did I actually do that? Because I know I do that when I'm not supposed to be doing it.
It was great though. It was fun.
That was such a good gig.
Who was the other singer? What was her name? Jayando.
Jayando Balfour. She's amazing.
She's great as well.
Amazing soprano singer.
And you were singing, because you weren't singing, it was in a different language as well, wasn't it? So a lot of it.
We sang a Yoruba song called Aiko Biaye. That was really cool. We sang Come Down Off Your Throne and Leave Your Body Alone. That was cool. What else did we do? We did a few songs. Some of them didn't necessarily have vocals at the time, but I think Ginger wanted some lyrics written to them because he really wanted to add some vocals to Air Force, which was really cool.
Yeah.
what else did we do? We did a few, and it was really fun.
It was awesome. The only thing that ruined it for me was that some super Ginger Baker fans stood right in front of me. They were Americans as well. And they were like, hey, man. And they just had the phone out all the way through, and it was like, oh.
Oh, he's the best. Like, honestly.
He's cool, though. He's super cool.
He is. I think a lot of people were really scared at first because they were like, have you watched? Have you read? Have you heard? Yeah. And it's like, he's what, 78 or 76? He's a great guy. Like, young people have tough lives and stuff, but he didn't do anything wrong to me. No. And he's great. Gave me a good gig. I got to meet really great people, and I hope that we still remain friends.
Well, the band was awesome as well. Yeah. Like, because the bass player was the MD for it, wasn't he?
Oh, gosh, yeah. Amazing.
Yeah. And you could tell, like, it was the first night, so you were all, like, looking at each other, just making sure that you were all going to this same part or whatever. And because he'd been ill, he didn't have enough rehearsal time, but it was nobody would have known, and it was great.
Yeah.
And he was super ill at the time as well, and he still managed to do it, so... Yeah. It's great, but no, we need to do this again when we've got more time, because we're going to get kicked out of this room in a minute. We're down at Storm Rehearsal Studios in.
Come to Storm.
Is this Islington? Is this
Holloway?
Holloway.
Road.
Yeah, Holloway Road. So.
I've not actually been inside before.
Yeah, it's really cool. I like it. I'm hoping that at some point I can talk to him and maybe get him to.
A little endorsement or sponsorship, maybe.
They might watch this podcast and go, we're not putting our names on that.
Oh, no, I think they would. Like, did you hear yourself playing guitar? Like, kind of needs to happen.
Yeah. I'm not sure.
Jim's really good at playing guitar. He's always very much in denial, and he always kind of talks down about himself, but it's really annoying. Because
it's called modesty. Or it's called realism.
Or stupidity, because he's really good, and he's like, no, I'm just rubbish. I'm like, no. Yeah.
I get by.
You get by, yeah. No, you're all right. Babies aren't so bad either.
What, sorry?
Your BVs, they're not so bad, do you?
Oh, thank you so much.
They're getting better, man.
I'm working on it. Again, going to the jam nights, listen to all the backing singers at Chiro's, particularly, is a big help. The first night I ever went to Ronnie's, I walked in on my own, I didn't know anybody, I was ill. Just had my guitar, because you just take my guitar at that point. You don't need a guitar, just turn up and use a guitar. Yep. And never been to Ronnie's, didn't know anything about the scene or anybody, I was there on my own. Watched it, saw all these amazing players, a lot of them that I know now.
Mm.
And then all of a sudden, these gospel backing singers walked in,
mm-hmm.
these three ladies, and I stood there, and they just, in the middle of all the songs, started singing three-part harmony around me. Mm-hmm. So I had three-part harmony going on around me.
Surround sound.
It was the most trippiest, weirdest experience. It's so amazing, hearing it. And and that's one of the things I love about the Chiro's Jam as well, is that they've got the BVs going all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I have friend Chris Moncrief. He's one of the regular backing vocalists.
Yeah,
and it just makes it all the difference on that jam as well.
Definitely.
Shantéh, you're amazing, and you've got. Are we allowed to make? Are you making some sort of announcement soon?
Yeah.
This is going to come out in a week on Monday, just so you know.
A week on Monday.
Will that be after or before?
A week on Monday.
Yeah.
So Monday coming, a week after that.
Yeah.
Oh, it'll be my birthday after that. I would have turned 25, and I would have probably said it then.
Yeah.
So maybe I can say it now.
Yeah, I won't release it till then.
Okay, so I'm putting out my EP.
Yeah.
And I'm putting it out on the 22nd of June.
Excellent.
My birthday is the 22nd of May.
Yeah.
I'm having a listening party on the 22nd of May.
Right, so give us the social media stuff about this. Where can we follow you and check out all of this so we can stay in touch with it?
Social media, Shantéh Fuller. Facebook, Shantéh, everything is Shantéh Fuller.
It's all going to be in the description as well, so you can check it down there.
I'll spell it though.
Yeah, go ahead and spell it. Yeah.
I won't spell it the northern way.
Okay.
Shantéh Fuller. There's no underscore, there's no hyphen, there's nothing. It's just all together.
Twitter, Instagram,
Facebook.
You've got Facebook.
Periscope. The Periscope's great. I'm going to stream the listening party.
Awesome.
On Periscope.
Well, I'll share the link for that, definitely.
Yay. It's actually, I can tell you because you're coming, so it's all right. Yeah. But it's my birthday, and I thought, why don't I just do a listening party at my birthday so that I can have people that I know, like, in my house.
Self-obsessed much?
No.
I'm joking. Whatever. No,
I just want people that I know in my house rather than, like, people like, oh, yeah, this is great. Just know who I am, though. It'd be a bit weird.
Don't give the address out.
No, I won't do that. That'd be a bit weird.
No, check Shantéh's music out. It's amazing. It'll be a... I'll put links and stuff to all of this stuff. And thank you so much for being on the podcast.
Thanks for having me.
Also, one of the first people I met on the jam scene in London, and I appreciate you for being so nice and warm to me.
You're so sweet.
Asking me to play for you as well on the gig. So,
Jim's on the EP. he played on the EP, and he's in denial about
if
sharing
I was,
it.
If I was Dre, I'd be editing a lot on that.
No, it's really good. We, Andre's doing some creative goodness to it right now, and awesome. Your parts sound really great. So, yeah, it's really good.
Awesome, awesome. Thank you so much. Let's leave it there, because we're going to have to get packed up or else we're going to get into trouble. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
The Kind of About Music podcast.